Which brings us then to the thing that can really undo all of us, which is, this is an old newsletter. I wrote this in 2002, seems like eons ago, during the dot-com crash. And it was 7 Habits of Highly Ineffective Investors. I was looking for reasons why investors underperform markets. And one of them, which I've gone over, some of you have heard this one before, we have over-optimism. Basically, you can ask any group of people if they're above average, and 80% of them will say they're in the top 50% of anything. So the question's irrelevant. 80% of us are simply above average, automatically. So there's a great book by James Monte called A Little Book of Behavioral Investing, which sort of explains the theories behind all of this. But really what shook me was I found this old quote from this book, and it said the following. 2006 survey of 300 fund managers, 76% said they were above average. The other 24% said they were average. So 100% were average or better. So this is my world, okay? So we are unbelievably good. I was just thinking Donald Trump would make a great fund manager, don't you? And then the deadly trio of sort of the behavioral sins includes cognitive dissonance. I agree with every fact that agrees with me. Another choice is, this is a Mark Twain quote, it ain't what you know, don't know that gets into you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just ain't so. Confirmation bias. So we look for things that confirm a decision we've already made. And then overconfidence. We just stretch too far for something, in this case, not a bridge, but an apple. And my favorite one has always been this one, gambling with house money, which is where we're all in as long as we win first. So people get more aggressive as soon as they're ahead. They just increase that bet that they have to make. And loss aversion is an interesting one because it's the antithesis of the gambling with house money, which is gains and losses. We feel twice the pain from a loss as we do joy from a gain. Therefore, we do whatever we can to avoid losses. Now, why is this all a problem? Well, let's look at this from a cycle perspective. Here's a market going up and down, like a bit of a roller coaster, which is what markets do. So at the beginning, as the market's rising, I am brilliant. I am in a state of euphoria. Then all of a sudden, things get a little shaky, and you start to wobble. Now, that wobbling likely might have occurred for a lot of people at the end of last year, after seeing markets kind of be down 10 or 15 or 20%. And then finally, if you get something like 2008, you are in total distress. Why would I make that mistake? I never want to touch another stock or any other asset that could drop that much ever again. Now, here's the problem. Your highest risk is when you feel best. Your lowest risk is when you feel worst. And that is a very, very hard thing psychologically to overcome. So behavioral finance is all about this. He who conquers himself is the mightiest warrior, Confucius. This is a book I'd recommend for any of you to get. It was written by a guy named Daniel Crosby. He's a PhD psychologist and a pretty good investor. And he writes all about some of the things I've touched on here. If you really want to understand a little bit about the human psyche and mainly how to master it in yourself, this is a book worth reading. Can you sell when you are winning? Can you buy when you're losing? That's the question. And if we take a look at what impact this has over time, keeping in mind we're not talking about market returns. So Dalbar does this study, and this study comes out every year, and they've been doing it for 30 or 40 years, where they measure the performance of investors against the actual markets. Now you have to appreciate, and I think I've used this line before, if all you did was simply take 100 lobotomized monkeys and had them throw darts, you know, at some kind of, you know, digital stock market, they would get basically the average of the stock market. It has to be, it's just a probability exercise. So in order to underperform the market when you're buying, say, an exchange-traded fund or an index, you have to be worse than those 100 lobotomized monkeys. So really behavioral finance is about why is that true? And when you take a look at investor performance, the stock market, and the performance lag, over time, the difference is 3 to 5% annual loss. So it was interesting to look this year, how did investors do in 2018 when the market was in fact down? It wasn't down tons, it was down about 4, 5%. But the investor's performance was 5% worse than that, a loss of 9.42% for the year. So again, there's virtually no exceptions to this. We don't do this study in Canada, but we wouldn't get any different results here.